All right, let's move over to the AFC North here. We'll start with Baltimore. They have the 30th pick in the first round. Their win total is, I believe, the highest in the league. It's tied at 11.5.
Healthy.
44% chance to win the AFC North. I just don't know about that. I
was going to ask you about this. So the Ravens, I think it's weird that the Ravens have almost a 1-2 shot to win the AFC North.
This is a tough division, and I don't know.
The Ravens got brain drained. Mike McDonald, the defensive coordinator, left. They lost their defensive line coach. They lost a bunch of players. They lost, the front office. The Ravens were brain drained for the first time. Like, we've seen Belichick have to cycle through three entire staffs in 5 or 6 years. The Ravens, this is the first time. And Danny Kelly, Joe Ortiz, the Danny Kelly doppelganger, went to run the Chargers front office. And I look, and like the Ravens still have like Kyle Van Noy is going to be their edge rusher. And I'm like, yeah, I don't know. It's weird to me, but I this is a team that needs a lot of edge defense. They need edge rushers. They need cornerbacks. But like, I don't think the Ravens are going to win the division this year.
They're in a weird spot, I feel like. I feel like this is the year after it was supposed to happen. So we're in this like weird letdown. The vibes are kind of, you know, weird. Greg Roman left. They had this new offense. It seemed to be going great. They flame out once again in the playoffs. And now we're in like this weird era where it's like, are the vibes still high? Is the optimism still there? The defense isn't going to be as good as it was. That kept them in a lot of games last year. They were never losing. And so, I don't know. To me, the momentum is not working in the Ravens' favor right now.
So, like, I agree that there are Ravens concerns. The straw that stirred the drinks last year, when you talk about like why the Ravens are successful, Todd Monken, Lamar Jackson, Mike McDonald, I do think they only lost like one of the big three in terms of like Lamar's taking the big step forward, the coordinator changes that they have. I feel good about that. The other thing is like, this is a difficult division, and the Ravens have their red flags. So do the Browns, so do the Steelers, so do the Bengals. Like, this entire division is going to be impossible to handle because the Ravens have, I agree, the Ravens are too big of a favorite to win this division. I still think they should be the favorite. Yeah, but the Bengals, man, like, you got Joe Burrow coming back off injury. That defense last year was abysmal. Worst explosive play defense in the league. Cleveland Browns, don't need to go into what their problems are. Joe Flacco is playing in that playoff run. Pittsburgh Steelers, Russell Wilson versus Justin Fields to see who goes 9-8, right? Like, I have no doubt that this division is going to be tough. It's going to be close down the stretch. But while the Ravens have their red flags like everybody else does, Ravens to me, like, edge makes sense. I do think that this defense will always not need elite edge play. Like, I think that it can always be one of the reasons why it works is that it doesn't require elite edge play. Corner, I think, is more so where they need their bread buttered, and they performed really well there last year, but corner wouldn't surprise me. Offensive line, right? They lose both John Simpson and Morgan Moses. Ronnie Stanley was like playing half a series, taking a series off last year. Like, they are, the offensive line to me is the spot where it's like, okay, you have a couple of starters. You love what you have in Linderbaum. They lost Kevin Zeiler as well, dude. Like, they desperately need more bodies in the offensive trenches.
Yeah, and to that point, I actually want to plant a flag here. I think if there's not a great lineman at the spot, the Ravens pick 30th, I think there's actually going to be a quarterback taken here. I think that a team that wants Michael Penix Jr. is probably going to swap up and with this 30th pick that the Ravens have.
A fifth quarterback goes in the first round, I will be irate.
How much money are you going to lose?
Hey, good business for the Ravens. Charge them a lot. Move back.
How much money do you lose if Michael Penix goes in the first round? Solak.
Oh, my exposure on under 4.5 quarterbacks in the first round is pretty substantial. That would be a negative experience for me.
How substantial? Like, would you have to sit down with your wife and explain?
Do you disclose your betting habits with your partner?
Yes, Mayor knows. No, I never will place enough on one bet where, like, if I lose this, I would have to like be like, Mayor, like, guess what? We just lost. This is terrible. There are definitely days where I sit down and I'm like, dude, I was mistreated by the gods of luck today. But like, overall, no, like, I'm not a big limit better, nor do I want to be a big limit.
But you're
better,
getting your future baby a nicer crib though. If Michael Penix is a
in terms, problem. Oh, already, I built the crib this last weekend, baby. It's nice as heck. Don't talk about how nice my baby's crib is. I got the Ferrari cribs up there. I just, when it comes to, you know, like, a lot of what I'll do in the draft is just buying, you know, long shot odds that I think like have the chance of aging well and eventually getting closing line value. But every so often the draft is a knowledge market and you want to be able to put pretty substantial money down on something that you think is like a near certainty. And I would be just stunned if we get a fifth quarterback in the first round. I'd be flabbergasted.
All right, we'll come back to that a little later.
All right, let's go to Cincinnati then. Cincinnati, 18th pick in the draft, 10.5 win total this year. They have the second best odds to win the AFC North. They're plus 165, so a little bit below Baltimore. Heifetz, I'm guessing you're going to say that the Bengals need to get better in the trenches, both offensively and defensively.
Yeah, basically. I mean, I think the Bengals kind of have a wandering eye. Some teams replace guys when they're gone. The Bengals replace guys while they're still there. Like when the Bengals have a starter that's going to leave in a year, they just bring in the new guys. So like they did that with Jesse Bates. They brought in Dax Hill. And they're like, hey, Jesse, will you train Dax? And then he did. And then he left. And they keep doing that. I think that the three spots the Bengals need for 2025, which I think is how the Bengals look at this. T. Higgins is the obvious one, right? I think that T. Higgins, I don't think the Bengals trade him because I think the Bengals want to make a Super Bowl run one last time with this whole group, but then I do think T. Higgins leaves. And I think a receiver for Cincinnati will fill that void in 2025. But to your point about the trenches, they need a right tackle. Like they have Orlando Brown Jr. on the left side. I think a right tackle like an Amarius Mims out of Georgia, like couldn't redshirt for a year. They have Trent Brown signed for a 1-year deal, and then Amarius Mims could step in for 2025. And then just defensive tackle. The Bengals couldn't stop the run, and then they lost their best run stopping tackle. So, but in the first round, I think the Bengals go right tackle. Like I'm really confident the Bengals go tackle.
Yeah. I think offensive line makes most sense for the Bengals. I will say that from what I understand, they're pretty sensitive about their edge rusher spot. Opposite Trey Hendrickson, where Hendrickson's been so good for them, but like Sam Hubbard's had health problems. Joseph Asai hasn't developed for them. They took Miles Murphy in the first round last year. He couldn't break the rotation. I do think adding to the pass rush is also on the table for them.
All right, moving on. Cleveland, no first rounder because of the Deshaun Watson trade. 8.5 win total for 2024. Third best odds to win the AFC North, 15% chance. Heifetz, what do you got for Cleveland?
So, doing team needs, I look at Cleveland and I'm like, Cleveland just needs Deshaun Watson to play better. Like they, like going through the all these team needs, they get to Cleveland. They have no first rounder. The Browns have 3 picks in the top 200. For context, the Cardinals have 10 picks in the top 200. The Browns have 3. So I look and I'm like, they already made their bets. They traded for Jerry Jeudy as receiver. Like the Browns are just adding backups and stuff. It's like the Browns made the playoffs last year with Joe Flacco at quarterback and like a third string left tackle and a third string right tackle. It's like Deshaun Watson just needs to play like a quarterback that they traded 3 first for and gave $250 million.
How many more first rounders would they trade away for Deshaun Watson to play well for a guarantee? 2 more?
100% guarantee all of them. Guaranteed good quarterback play, you trade the whole world.
Oh, I've been meaning to ask you this. How many firsts would you give for Patrick Mahomes?
7. As many as I could.
Like, would you give 10?
Well, can't you not trade? How many years?
Yeah, you're not allowed to trade more than 3.
You can only trade 3 years in the future.
But let's get rid of that rule. Would you give like 20 first rounders for Mahomes? I think I would. I'm not kidding. What are you going to do with 20 first rounders? Yeah,
20? I don't think so.
Yes,
I'm not giving 20. Dude, I'm not going to be alive in 20 years. Like, that's
exactly.
Not even like,
exactly.
That's the point. That's the point. So, like, you know why? What are you supposed to do with the 20 first rounders? Go to Super Bowl. What gives you a better chance of going to a first rounder, going to a Super Bowl? 2 firsts the next 20 years or Patrick Mahomes? I think it's Mahomes.
Heifetz is essentially saying, like, let's just drink 20 beers tonight. It'll be a really fun night. Yeah. And then, like, who cares what happens the rest of the way? Look, if you're a GM and you spend 20 first round picks, you're gonna get fired anyway. So might as well just have Patrick.
You got it right. What you have to do is you have to trade 20 first round picks and immediately retire. And then be like, I'm leaving the next guy with a great position. He's got Mahomes. If he can't build it, it's not my bad.
I asked this. I know this sounds stupid, but I asked this because I said to the Giants should trade up for Caleb Williams, and I'd give up 4 firsts to do it. And people said I was insane, and I was like,
Go to your
team's draft page and look at the last 4 first round picks and tell me if you want those guys for Caleb Williams.
Look, anyway. 4, I can get behind. 20 is a lot, but
You know what? Yeah, that's fair. That's probably my point. Anyway, speaking of your team.
Yeah, let's go to Pittsburgh here. Steelers have the 20th pick in the draft. They're over under 7.5. They won 10 games last year with Kenny Pickett and Mason Rudolph. And you're telling me they're going to be 3 wins worse with Justin Fields and Russell Wilson? Yeah, they have a 10% shot, according to FanDuel, to win the division. I feel like the Steelers need a center, they need a tackle, they need receivers, they need a corner. But I don't think they're going to take a wide receiver. The Steelers don't take wide receivers in the first round. They're too cocky. They're system, you know. Right. I think
they're too good at taking it in the second round.
100%. Like they believe in their ability to develop guys. So I don't think they're going to take a wide receiver in the first. To me, I think they're going to take an offensive tackle.
With the receiver, do you guys have a friend who will always order like a Miller Lite or Coors Light, regardless of how nice the place they are is?
Yeah, that's my brother.
Yeah, it's like they'll be in like a 5-star Michelin restaurant. They're like, do you have Coors?
And
like,
you got Miller High Life on draft?
Yeah. That's the Steelers. They're not going to do a first rounder, but I do think they take a right tackle and they move Broderick Jones to left.
To left.
Because they took him in the first round last year. And the Steelers moved up. They jumped the Jets because Bill Belichick wanted to screw over the Jets. And they jumped the Jets to take a tackle. I kind of think the Steelers do that again. I think the Steelers move up a little bit and jump the Bengals and take a tackle too. I kind of wonder if they do that.
Get a Marius Mims, dude. Marius Mims, Broderick Jones, Darnell Washington, George Pickens. Let's build ourselves a 2021 national champion Georgia. Their 2022 national champion Georgia team. I love it.
Yeah, I mean, it all makes sense to me. The Steelers have not had a good offensive line in a long time. And I would like to give Russell Wilson at least some time to throw his moon balls.
I was thinking Graham Barton out of Duke is kind of like David DeCastro. There's a lot of Steelers-y players in this draft that they'll get.
I'm excited for the second or third round wide receiver that the Steelers draft. I can't wait. Whoever it is, they're going to be great.
So if not
wound
receiver and not...
third round wide receiver is a tongue twister.
That's tough. No, I'll give you that one. If not wide receiver and not offensive tackle, is there a position that stands out to you, Craig?
Corner.
Yeah.
We got nothing behind Joey Porter.
The reason why I'm asking that is because, yeah, they have unbelievably, inarguably, the most nothing of all nothing behind Joey Porter. And yes, I know they just traded for Dante Jackson. I'm saying what I'm saying. And they are in a spot where I think they could kick off like the second tier of corners, the Cooper DeJean run, the Kool-Aid McKenzie run, the Nate Wiggins run. I think corners is a decent shot for the Steelers round one.
Yeah, I'd be okay with that too. Offensive tackle or corner would be my preference.